So we wanted to discuss tonight about the benefits and the methods of associating with devotees. So I wanted to read from the Nectar of Instruction, text 4. Dadati pratigrinati guyamakya kiprichati bhunkte bojayate chaiva sadvidam pritilakshanam. Offering gifts in charity, accepting charitable gifts, revealing one's mind in confidence, inquiring confidentially, accepting prasad, and offering prasad are the six symptoms of love shared by one devotee and another. So I'm sure that most of us would like to accelerate our spiritual life. Most of you like your spiritual life to go faster and easier? Yes? So when we first take out Krishna consciousness, we often think that, oh, well, I'm going to become a pure devotee in just a few minutes. Maybe a few months. It might take a year or so. Okay? And then after a while, you see that although that is possible, Srila Prabhupada talked about how you can become Krishna conscious in a moment, that for most of us, it's not exactly like that. For most of us, as Prabhupada says, until the stage of nishtha, it's a hard struggle with determination. And we find that our hearts are not quite as clean and pure as we thought they were. Yes, in the beginning you think, I'm very pure, and after you chant for a while, you realize, oh, I'm not really so pure. I really have so many contaminations. And people always would like to know, is there some way that I could make this journey faster and easier? So of course, there's many answers to that question. You could say, by chanting with attention. So many different ways we could answer that question. I'm not saying that this is the only one, but this is certainly one of them. That how we choose to associate with devotees, what's our sadhu sangha? Satam prasanga mama virya sambhidom. Bhavanti vidkarna rasayanam katanta josan advatpa pavargavardhvani shradaratir bhakti anukramishyati. Sada prasanga, not just sangha, but prasanga, deep sangha with the devotees. In one sense, one could understand the process of advancing in Krishna consciousness as a process of increasing and increasing the quality of our association with the devotees. And just doing that one thing very nicely can immediately bring us to a high stage of Krishna consciousness. And messing up that one thing can, as we're told repeatedly, greatly impede our Krishna consciousness. So even if you're doing everything else right, if we're offending the Vaishnavas, we're not dealing nicely with the Vaishnavas, then we don't make much progress. Like Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasvati talked about the wedding party. You know, that they get in the boat to go to the other village and they're rowing all night. And when they wake up, they're still in the same place. Did you ever feel like that? And then they found out the anchor was in the ground. Like one of my friends recently wrote, I was cooking and cooking and I was wondering, why isn't anything cooking? And then I realized the stove wasn't turned on. Right? Like that. So if our dealings with the devotees is not proper, then all the activities we're doing in devotion have very little effect. And if the activities we're doing with the devotees are proper, then it turbojets our advancement in Krishna consciousness. So it'd be a good thing to get right. So here in the purport of Nectar of Instruction, text 4, Srila Prabhupada makes two very, very interesting statements, almost amazing, incredible statements. He says, the International Society for Krishna Consciousness has been established to facilitate these six kinds of loving exchanges between the devotees. Indeed, one of the purposes of ISKCON is to bring the members closer to Krishna and closer to each other. After all, our idea is that in the spiritual world, it's not that we're just associating with Krishna alone, off in some, you know, just us and Krishna off somewhere. But it's in a whole society. It's in a perfect society. Prabhupada says in the spiritual world, there's no sannyasis. What are you going to renounce? Oh, children are welcome. Hey, you don't have to leave because children are making noises. I was thinking how ironic it is that I'm giving class in this temple room. How we women were treated when I lived here. Anyway, Hare Krishna. Anyway. So in order to actually enter into the society of Krishna consciousness, into Goloka Vrindavan, that is a society where the devotees are not only dealing with Krishna, but they're dealing with each other. It's a whole village where everyone has relationships with each other. And Prabhupada talked about how our society will exist also. How our society will exist also in the spiritual world. Of course, not quite in the same way that it exists here. It's not that there'll be GBC meetings in Goloka Vrindavan. I'm sure the GBC certainly hope there will not be GBC meetings in Goloka Vrindavan. But it's interesting, if you really think about, why did Prabhupada establish a society? Why wasn't it just ISKCON, International Krishna Consciousness? In fact, I think we've been pretty good at the International Krishna Consciousness bit. I think we've been pretty good at the ISKCON. And we haven't quite got the ISKCON, yes? Mm-hmm. We're kind of still working on the S part. We're coming up to the 50th anniversary of the incorporation of ISKCON. But as, what does a society mean? A society means that not only are each of us as individuals coming to love Krishna, but we're coming to have also relationships with each other. Just like there are some Christian monasteries where the monks all take vows of silence, the Cistercian monks, I think they're called, and each of them just stays in their own little room. They don't talk to anybody. And they each just do their own little study and prayer. They each just do their own little study and prayer in their own room. And somebody just comes by once or twice a day and silently gives them a piece of bread and a bowl of soup and then walks away. And a few times a day they come together and pray in the same room, and then they immediately go off back into their little rooms. So that's not a society, is it? It's a retreat, but it's not a society. So therefore, Prabhupada is saying, the International Society for Krishna Consciousness has been established to facilitate these six kinds of loving exchanges. Otherwise, why build a society? Just simply give out the books and tell everybody, go in your own house, in your own room, and develop your relationship with Krishna. But it's meant that we can also relate with each other. And then Srila Prabhupada goes on in the purport to say, the life of the Krishna conscious society is nourished by these six types of loving exchange among the members. So if we want to know how to be, how to have a healthy society, how to make ISKCON healthy, how to make our working together for Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's mission, for Srila Prabhupada's mission, one that's full of nourishment, that's full of health and vitality. If we think of nourishment, we think of food, huh? And nourishing food is food that tastes good and makes you feel satisfied, you digest it easily, you have energy after you eat. That was what we would call nourishing food. So when we have the kind of relationships with devotees that Rupa Goswami is describing, then that is also how we will feel in our society. We'll feel happy, we'll feel energized, we'll be able to deal with each other smoothly. So what are the benefits of associating with devotees? Can some of you suggest what are the benefits? I hate to make you work hard at the end of the day, but I just traveled from Paris today, so I'm working hard, so I can make you work a little hard too, right? If you wonder why I'm a little subdued today, it's because I'm a little tired. So if you think I'm acting subdued, you're right. I am a little subdued. Yes? Yes?
You feel comfortable because you're with like minds.
Oh. So that's definitely one of the benefits, to be comfortable when you're with like-minded people. It's very interesting that you say that. You know, Prabhupada often talks about that one of the benefits of association with devotees is the same as if you want to exchange stocks and you go to the stock exchange rather than being 300 miles away. Your business is done better, but it's nice to be with like-minded people. In fact, that's one of the main reasons I decided to move into the ashram way back when, because I was going to college and it was so difficult to talk about God with anybody. You know, I mean, it was just so difficult. You get together with your friends and you talk about something spiritual and something about God, and they talk, you know, 5 minutes, and then they say, okay, let's go get a pizza. Right? It's just not where they're at. It's interesting that it is said in the 10th canto, I believe it's in the 35th chapter, about how the cloud is, I think it's both in the 21st and the 35th chapter, there's almost an identical verse there, one in the description of Krishna's food and one with the gopis' feelings of separation, where it describes that the cloud is the friend of Krishna, mega suridam. The cloud is described as suridam. Rida means heart, su means very dear, that the cloud is very dear to the heart of Krishna. And one of the reasons given is that the cloud is the same color as Krishna. So that's kind of interesting, isn't it? Why would the cloud be dear to Krishna? Because it's the same color. But we tend to be with people who are like us. You know, even people do tend to associate with those that have the same color skin as they do, isn't it? They do. Or come from the same country, or from the same part of the same country, and speak with the same accent. Isn't it like that? I remember when, after I was traveling in China for 10 days, where nobody spoke English, except for my translator. No one even said hello. I mean, not a word of English. And when I was leaving the country at the airport, there were some other people waiting in the line who were not only speaking English, but they were speaking American English. And not only were they speaking American English, they were speaking American English with a Northeastern accent. And I was like, whoa, friends. So this is just, it's natural that we like to be with people who are like us. That's one reason we're so attached to family. Like Arjuna had this problem on the battlefield, Swajana, my own people. You know, this sense of my family, my religion, my race, my color, my ethnicity, my nationality, my, well, they had this Red Sox game going on out there, my baseball team fans. Right? Isn't it? So the cloud also has a similar mentality to Krishna, that it likes to relieve the suffering of the people by pouring down rain. So Krishna likes to be with others who are like him, who have similar mentalities to him. And it's very pleasing, if you want to be a devotee of Krishna, to be with other devotees of Krishna, to be with other people. Machchitta madgata pranam bodhayantas prasparam. You feel satisfied and you feel blissful when you're with people you can just talk to about Krishna and you're not weird. Isn't it? When you want to become a devotee of Krishna, you immediately become really, really weird. If you haven't already noticed this. Manushyanam sahasreshu kasya jyajati siddhayayatitam abhisiranam kasya mam veditatvataha. I mean, especially if you want to, oh, hi, Krishna Prabhu. Thank you for the prasadam today. It was lovely. It's so nice to get your cookie again after so long. Right? So when, especially if you dress like this, you know, if you openly advertise yourself as a devotee of Krishna, then you're really weird. And I remember the first time that I went to India, I was so excited before I went, thinking I'll finally go someplace where I won't be weird. But I was weirder in India. I got more stares in India than I get in the West. So yes, one benefit is you get to be with people who support what you want to do, that you can, to whom you're not strange, to whom you're normal. Like early in the movement, there was that leaflet, who is crazy? And one benefit to having sweet relations with devotees is you're finally with people who don't think you're crazy, who want to talk about Krishna, who want to talk about Srila Prabhupada, who want to talk about the mission, who want to talk about philosophy, and who find great happiness in that. That's lovely. I didn't even have that on my list. I love it when people say things that aren't on my list. Any other benefits of having wonderful association with devotees? I'm going to add that to my list, though, for the next time I teach this. Any other benefits? Yes?
Become more, like, enthusiastic and inspired to, like, do service. And
oh, definitely. Definitely. We get inspired, hopefully. Actually, that really depends on the quality of our association, isn't it? But the benefit of having wonderful association is you get inspired. You see, oh, well, there's somebody who's doing it. If they can do it, I can do it. By the way, we should be careful about any time we see advanced devotees putting them into some kind of special category. This is a little caveat. Like any time a devotee is your advance, if you start saying, well, they must be a nitya-siddha devotee, or they must be this, then a lot of the inspiration value is gone. Does that make sense to everybody? Because then all of a sudden, they're not like me anymore. Oh, well, there's some pure devotee category. But definitely one reason to associate with devotees and have sweet association with devotees is we get inspired by other people's faith. Yes, by other people's example also. And we think, yes, I can do it. And their example acts as a model for how I can do it. Now, each of us in one sense has to do things in our own way, according to our own situation and our own inspiration. It's actually quite a big mistake to take exactly what someone else does and try to just copy-paste it onto your life. Having said that, you can look at what other people are doing and take that as a model. And say, all right, here's somebody who's showing an example. What can I pick up from this person's example that I can use in my own life? If I can't do exactly what they're doing, then how can I pick up the principle of what they're doing? So we get a general sort of inspiration and enthusiasm, and we also get a template. Some other benefits of having nice devotee association. Yes, Prabhu.
We develop your relationships based on spiritual values.
Oh, that's also very nice. I also didn't have that on my list. Rather than on exploitation and sense gratification. Very nice. Some other thoughts? Yes.
Just thinking, that was great. Exploitation and sense gratification, that about sums it up.
It does just about sum it up. Yes, it does. Yes, it does. Very, very well, actually. Material relationships are based on exploitation and sense gratification. Beginning, middle, end of story. Unfortunately. What about making Krishna happy? Oh, did you want to suggest something? Yes. Easier to trust. Oh, very nice. We're all looking for trust, aren't we? Desperately so. And in ordinary materialistic relationships, you cannot trust because they are exploitive and because they're phony. People's relationships are based on a phony identity. We're pretending to be something and somebody that we're not on the material level. And on the spiritual level, we're at least trying to act as if we're a devotee of Krishna, which is who we really are. So at least we're trying to act authentically. You know, we may not do a very good job of it all the time, but at least we're making an attempt. Like you guys were fighting over who would give each other the mat in one of the funny cultures in our Hare Krishna movement. Who can, you know, out in the world people are fighting over who can take for themselves, and we're fighting over who can give. So it makes Krishna happy also when we associate nicely with devotees. Just like if any of you have more than one child, you're happy when the children get along. This is natural. Yes? If your children are fighting, you're not happy. And if your children are playing sweetly together, you become happy. When Krishna saw the Prachetas, the 10 brothers, all cooperating together in devotional service, he was very pleased. In a similar way, if you're running a project and the people who work in the project are cooperating together, it's very pleasing to the person. Or if you're running a company and your employees are getting along, it's very pleasing. Right? This is even in the Bible. Hine matovu manayim shevarahim gam yahad. How wonderful it is when brothers are sitting together in peace. So this is something that pleases Krishna very, very much. In fact, it's described in the 8th chapter of Majjalila, how the gopis are always getting more pleasure by inducing other gopis to be with Krishna than by being with Krishna themselves. It says that the gopis get 100 times more pleasure from seeing Radharani with Krishna than when they're with Krishna. And Radharani gets 10 million times more pleasure from seeing the other gopis with Krishna than her being with Krishna. And then it says, when Krishna sees this behavior of the gopis, he becomes very pleased. That everyone is working to facilitate everyone else's pleasure. Everyone is working to facilitate everyone else's happiness. So when Krishna sees these kinds of loving exchanges between the devotees, that rather than being envious, right, in the material world, generally we think there's a limited supply. I used to be in charge of the prasadam serve out in North Carolina for a few years, and on Janmashtami, and I would always make the servers make their own plates before they served. Because on Janmashtami, everybody's hungry, you know? And if I didn't do that, the servers would be very, how shall we say, stingy with some of the preps. because they wanted it and they were afraid, if I serve it out generously, there won't be anything left for me. If they had their own plates put aside, then they could serve nicely. So this is our general mentality. There's not enough to go around. And therefore, I'm happy to share as long as there's enough for me. Right? I'm not going to share if it means that I'm going to be without. But in the spiritual world, it's not like that at all. Everyone is simply giving. Of course, you can't artificially imitate that. But that is the principle, that when Krishna sees cooperation, when he sees that the devotees are facilitating each other's service, he feels very, very happy. In fact, there's very few things that please him as much as that. And in fact, as I mentioned earlier, when we associate properly with devotees, in this world, in these bodies, even in our conditioned state, we are preparing for life in the spiritual world. We read in Krishna book how that the perfect devotee generally goes first to the material planet where Krishna's having his pastimes. Yes, for training? So please don't think that the training just starts at death. Please don't think like that. Guess when the training starts? Like right now? Yes? So even now we're being trained. This movement is part of the Leela of Mahaprabhu. And he's training us how to become residents of the spiritual world. At least he's trying to train us. It depends how cooperative we are with the process of being trained. If we hang out in our International Society for Krishna Consciousness and just make it ICON instead of ISKCON, then we don't receive the training that the Lord is trying to give us. Now, it's quite interesting that we talked before, you mentioned about being inspired by the devotees. So this being inspired by other devotees happens also at very high levels of Krishna consciousness. So we can combine this idea that our relationships now are training us for our higher relationships and this concept of being inspired by the other devotees. By the way, I want to thank all of you for being very tolerant with the children. Prabhupada, one time when the devotees said, you know, when we say in the Prema Dwani prayers, all glories to the assembled devotees, Prabhupada said, that includes the children. And please remember that if any of us are not totally as serious as Dhruva Maharaj, then that's where we're going to be in about 50 years. Please treat them as you would like to be treated, because that may be exactly what happens. So for the very advanced devotees, their impetus for loving Krishna is also coming from other devotees. So we've been basing this discussion on Rupa Goswami's Upadesha Amrita, the fourth verse, but if we look at Rupa Goswami's Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, where he talks about rasa. Now often in the Hare Krishna movement, when we talk about rasa, we just talk actually about one component of rasa. We just talk about what's actually the sthayi bhav. So if we talk about rasa, we usually talk about, okay, you can have neutrality, servitorship, friendship, parental or conjugal relationships with Krishna, yes? And generally we think that's rasa, but that's not rasa. That's one part of rasa. Rasa has five parts. So one part is that relationship. Another part is, what is it that stimulates that relationship? What stimulates that relationship? So let's give a nice example with these children. So like if you look at one of these children, just looking at the child might make you feel parental, or it might make you feel annoyed, depending on how you feel about children. But you might have a sense of caring and protection. And if you see the way the parents are dealing with the children, that might increase those feelings. Does that make sense to you? If you see a mother holding her child with affection, the way the mother is dealing with the child can increase your own feelings of affection for the child. Does everybody understand that? Okay. So this is called vibhav. Vibhav is what stimulates the devotee's particular feelings. So what is it that brings out the devotee's feeling of Krishna is my master, or Krishna is my friend, or Krishna is my child, or Krishna is my beloved. That's part of rasa. There's also another three parts of rasa. But anyway, we're just going to talk about this one, which is called vibhav. And this vibhav has two main categories. One category is called alambana, and one's called udipan. So this alambana also has two subcategories, ashraya and vishaya. So ashraya is the devotee who loves Krishna. Vishaya is Krishna. So in other words, if you have a feeling of friendship for Krishna, if your eternal relationship with Krishna is one of his cowherd boys, for example, then Krishna himself brings out that feeling in you. But so do the other cowherd boys. So when you meditate on, when you see, when you hear about the other cowherd boys, that also brings out your friendly feeling with Krishna. Does that make sense to everybody? Understand that? Okay. So that's the alambana. And that's absolutely essential. Then the udipans, the other stimulus, are individual things like Krishna's flute, Krishna's peacock feather, Krishna's beauty. But included there also are the devotees. So the devotees can also act as udipans, as stimulus. Just like we're saying, you see the devotees, you get inspired. Oh, I'd like to serve Krishna like that. But in fact, the higher aspects of bhakti, the main practice is following a particular devotee. That is the main practice of Raghunuga Bhakti. Did you know that? What is the big difference between Vaidhi Bhakti and Raghunuga Bhakti? In Raghunuga Bhakti, you're following a particular devotee in a particular relationship. You're taking the shelter of that particular devotee. How that devotee serves Krishna. Just like Srila Prabhupada writes in the third chapter of the 10th canto, that those who have a mood of parental affection for Krishna, they meditate on Mother Yasoda churning butter. How she's singing about Krishna, how the flowers are falling out of her hair, and so forth. So therefore, this association with devotees and dealing with devotees is very important at all stages of bhakti. It's important to inspire us in the beginning stages, and it's important as the main means of advancement in the advanced stages. So would everybody like to have good association with devotees? Are you convinced? So how to do that? So that Rupa Goswami is describing in text 4. And he talks about three exchanges, each of which have a give and a take. So what are the three? Okay, revealing one's mind. And another is? Gifts. And? Prasadam. So your thoughts, gifts, and prasadam. Let's do, which should we do first? Let's do gifts. So each of these has a give and exchange. Now sometimes we think that devotees should just give. Like you guys were fighting over who was going to give the mat. That was so cute. We do that kind of thing all the time in the Hare Krishna movement. It's one of our cultures that we're supposed to fight over who's going to give. That we want to give. But receiving is also one of the six loving exchanges, with each of them, to give and to receive. So I remember one time I was talking to my husband about how I really didn't like to receive, and he said, I said, I feel like it's proud if I say, well, I'm going to take things from people. And he said, no, it's humble. You're admitting you can't do it alone, that you depend on others. Also, it's quite interesting, actually, before we get to gifts in particular, thinking about receiving, and why does Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu pray for ecstasy? Why does he say, when will my eyes be decorated with tears of love flowing constantly while I chant your holy name, and will my hairs be standing on end, will my voice be choking? Why is he saying that? Why is he saying, when am I going to be in ecstasy? He says, prema dana bina vyartha daridra jivana dasa kori bhetan mori deha prema dana. Anybody here from Bengal? We have any Bengalis here? Good. You won't know that I just really mispronounced your language then. So betan means a salary. Dasakori, I want to be your servant. Betan mori, I want the salary. Sometimes we have controversies in ISKCON, should devotees get salaries? So Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is asking for a salary. Betan means a salary. What is he asking for? Dasakori, betan mori, deha, give me prema dana. Dana means wealth. Give me the wealth of love. And it's interesting, Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Sarasvati translated this verse as give me ecstasy as my pay. So why would the Lord be asking for ecstasy? This is very nicely explained by Krishna Das Kaviraj. I believe it's in chapter 3 of Adi Lila, but it might not be. It might be chapter 4 or 5. I think it's in chapter 3, where he talks about the happiness of the gopis. And he was saying that the gopis feel great happiness in Krishna's service. So are they therefore selfish? Are they therefore interested in sense gratification? He said no, because their happiness gives happiness to Krishna. Huh? So specifically in relationship to gifts, when you give someone a gift, what do you want to see them do with it? Be happy with it. You want to see them use it, and you want to see them enjoy using it. Yes? So when I was in South Africa a few months ago, the devotee I was staying with gave me a sari, and I said, "Why? I really can't use this. I can't travel with it." And she said, "Well, could you at least wear it one day while you're here?" She wanted me to use it. And she wanted me to say, "Oh, I love it." Yes? So when we happily receive gifts, who are we pleasing? The giver. Isn't that interesting? Do you know one of the best ways to please Krishna is to be happy at the gifts he's given us and be happy with him? That is ecstasy in Krishna consciousness. If you really want to make Krishna happy, then as soon as you see him, you feel happy. Isn't that interesting? Wouldn't that make you happy? If as soon as someone saw you, they felt happy, wouldn't you like that? Yes? Do you want someone as soon as they see you, they're unhappy? Sometimes devotees ask, if I'm enjoying my service, is that Maya? I'm like, oh my God. Right? Krishna's happy if you enjoy your service. If as soon as you see him, you feel happy. As soon as you think of him, you feel happy. Susukam kartamaviyam. Of course, what is the main gift that we're giving and receiving that Prabhupada explains in this purport? Is what? The holy name. So again, to get that happily, to use it, to actually chant the holy name, and to chant the holy name with happiness. And Prabhupada says one should be eager to receive this transcendental gift. So giving it and receiving it. And then there's other kind of gifts also that we can give each other. And when we give gifts to each other, I've been talking about receiving, let's talk about giving. So in giving gifts, please try to give gifts that people actually want. Sometimes people give gifts because they just want to get rid of something. Or sometimes they give a gift because it's what they would want. Right? They don't think about what the other person would want. So I had an experience also recently where someone gave me a gift of a big glass bottle of olive oil. But I said, well, my suitcase is only this big. And if I put it in my suitcase, I'll have to wrap it all up so that the airlines don't break. Could you imagine a glass bottle of olive oil in your suitcase? My whole suitcase would have to be taken up by the bubble wrap. I wouldn't have any room for anything else, huh? And I said, and I don't have a kitchen in my suitcase. So the person who gave that to me, they weren't thinking, what am I doing? You understand? They're thinking, oh, I'd like some olive oil to cook with. And they weren't thinking, the person I'm giving it to, they're traveling from one place to another. They're not cooking. So it's quite interesting how many times, I'm sure all of us have gotten gifts that we looked at and went, thank you. Yeah? So when it, this is our principle, isn't it, of why we're vegetarian? I mean, we have so many reasons we're vegetarian, what kind of teeth we have, what kind of saliva we have, we don't want the animals to suffer. But ultimately we're vegetarian because we offer our food to Krishna, and he says, Patram Pushpam Palam Toyam. He says, don't give me meat. He doesn't like it. If you give it to me, he goes, ugh, I don't like this. So when we give gifts to the other devotees, we should think about what they would like. So that's giving and receiving gifts. Then giving and receiving prasadam. So with prasadam, we can talk about giving first. Prasadam also, please give people what they would like. You know, when Sri Caitanya Mahaprabhu serves prasadam, he gives everybody their favorite preparations. He knows what they would like. And that means, again, you have to know people. Oh, my goodness. You know, in order to give gifts that people really like and they really want to use, and in order to give prasadam that people really like to eat, you have to know them. What a radical thought. So, or to ask. So we do have a very individual, personal philosophy. And personality means, among other things, that we have things we like more than other things. One time at a festival, I turned to a devotee and said, this is really nice prasadam. And she said, all prasadam is nice prasadam. So even liberated souls have certain preparations they like more than other preparations. As soon as Mother Yasoda walks out of the room, Krishna takes off from his plate the preparations he knows his cowherd boyfriends like and puts it on their plate, what they like. Right? Even they have different, it's explained when Krishna killed the washerman in Mathura, and then he and Balaram took the clothes that they liked, the cloth that they liked, and then the cowherd boys also took the cloth that they liked. That means they have likes and dislikes. Right? Described each of the eternal residents of Goloka, what colors they like to wear. Like Nandamarsh really likes to wear green. Right? Krishna has likes, he really likes to wear yellow. I'm sure he can play any instrument. I'm sure Krishna could play a bass guitar. But he likes to play a flute. Maybe he plays a bass guitar sometimes, I don't know. But he has likes. So when we're serving prasadam to people, find out what they like. What kind of prasadam they like, what quantity they like. And again, when you're serving prasadam, it should be for the other person's pleasure. So one time I was at a place where they gave me like 50 preparations. How can I eat all of this? And I finally, you know, I was done. And then some more people come and they said, oh, more people have brought something. I said, I'm done. And they said, oh, if you don't eat anything, they'll be so upset. I was like, so we serve someone some prasadam. It shouldn't be for our gratification, but for their happiness. Right? And then we serve with respect, remembering we're not serving a plate, we're serving a person. Right? Don't put the sweet rice on top of the chutney and so forth and so on. Remember that we're serving prasadam. Treat the prasadam with respect. And then receiving prasadam, to remember that we're not getting prasadam from a spoon, but there's a person on the other end of the spoon. To thank the person, to thank the cooks. Right, to say something kind to the cooks, even if they really messed up with the cooking, which happens sometimes. To take only what we can properly eat. Right, to take only what we can properly digest. It's discussed earlier in the Nectar of Instruction that we can end up indulging in the tongue in the name of prasadam. If we're just thinking, oh, let me just eat this because it tastes very good. Or let me just eat the you know, the fancy stuff, then we're not eating in a mood of worship and in a mood of honor. And then there's revealing one's mind in confidence. Oh, I guess we should say something else about prasadam, although this might be a little controversial. But the best kind of prasadam is that which is cooked by persons who have a pure life and offered to Krishna on an altar where there's regulated worship, where the ingredients are very pure, where the kitchen is very clean. So the kitchen should be very clean, the ingredients should be very pure, the mind of the cook should be very pure, the worship should be done in a regulated way, the altar should be very clean, and so forth. So to have there are various levels of standards of prasadam. Right? It's not all in the same category. So going on to revealing one's mind in confidence. This is a very interesting one. On the best level, this means the tushanti cha ramanti cha. So if you can think about the last time that you got together with devotees and just talked about Krishna. Sometimes I think we're so afraid of being the sahajiyas, we don't want to talk about Krishna. Isn't that odd? It's supposed to be the International Society for Krishna Consciousness. I mean, you can hang out for a month and never hear anybody talk about Krishna. So the best way of exchanging confidences is really to talk about Krishna. Krishna's form, Krishna's qualities, Krishna's name, Krishna's pastimes. And it's so enlivening whenever you do that. Can you think about the last time you did that with somebody? When you were talking about what you read and what Krishna's pastimes were and how wonderful he is and how you can see him everywhere, right? When I was flying today, when we were flying into Iceland, and there's this, you know, you see this huge expanse of the ocean, and I was thinking about how Krishna says, of bodies of water, I'm the ocean. And just meditating on how this is one planet. There's only one planet. And yet the oceans on this planet are so big. They're huge, incredible. And so many planets with so many oceans. How great is God? How incredibly great, beyond comprehension. So this is the best kind of confidences to share. Now, sometimes we have to share confidences about our problems. I need a devotee that I don't know at all. And this is often where it comes from. People that you don't know at all who decide they can tell their deepest, darkest secrets to you because they don't know you and you don't know them, and therefore you're not going to embarrass them in their community. Yes. So that may have to be there sometime. We may have to go to some people with our deepest, darkest secrets and problems and etc. But generally, our revealing our mind in confidence is not that I dump the garbage of my mind on you. Right? I don't really think any of us, anybody here would like to put all the contents of their mind up for public display? No. So nor do we really need to hear all the contents of someone else's mind. Don't want to tell anybody in their local area. They figure they won't see you again for a year or two. So they'll, and maybe not at all. And so they'll come and tell you what they won't tell anybody else. And some of it's really horrific. And some of it you're just like, afterwards, where's the shower? And so when we reveal our mind in confidence, we should try to do so in ways that inspire one another. Although it is also required sometimes that we lean on each other's shoulders and cry on each other's shoulders and come to each other with our burdens and our embarrassments and our difficulties. Because in fact, sometimes just the fact of revealing something embarrassing to somebody may make it easier to deal with and easier to get rid of. It's a kind of relief. But this expressing our mind in confidence should also be done according to the relationship and according to the ability of the other person to assimilate. So one of the offenses is preaching the glories of the holy name to the faithless. So when we reveal our mind in confidence, when we talk about Krishna, we should not talk about things that are too high or too low for the listener. It should be a reciprocation where both persons will benefit. So there's five austerities of speech listed in the Bhagavad Gita. Anybody know the five austerities of speech? Truthful, yes.
Pleasing.
Pleasing, good.
Beneficial.
Okay. Anybody else?
Accurate.
Accurate, truthful, yeah. You got truthful, pleasing, beneficial. Pleasing means the content, the message. There's two more.
Not
agitating to others, which means the words. And the last? Any of you who talk every day really ought to know this. If you'd never talk at all during the day, it's not a very important thing to know. But if you ever talk during the day, it might be something useful to know. The last one is to regularly recite the Vedic literatures. So austerity of speech, it should be true. We shouldn't speak lies. The content should be pleasing. The message itself should be pleasing. You know, formerly, people used to reward messengers who brought good news and punish messengers who brought bad news. Is that interesting? Suppose we still did that in society. What would happen to gossip? Okay, so the content pleasing, the words pleasing. So modern society, they intentionally like to speak in agitating words, in rough language, and beneficial and based on the Vedas. So of those five, what's the most important?
Not agitating.
No, because sometimes you can use agitating language. Sometimes you can, and sometimes your message can even be not pleasing. Nope. Well, if you recite the Vedas, as Prahlada Nandaswami pointed out to me, all the others will naturally be there. But the most important is beneficial. See, if it benefits someone, you can't even give a painful message and even in agitating words. Hey, you fool, you're about to fall off the cliff, stop! No, so that's all right if it's going to benefit them. So this exchange of confidence should be such that both the hearer and the speaker are benefited, right? If I tell you something truthful, it doesn't help you. If I go to you and say, you know, your baby's really ugly. So that may be true. I actually once knew a woman who had a really ugly baby. It looked like a little pig. He really looked like a pig. But that's not beneficial, although it's truthful. And even the truths that are in the Vedas, one has to decide what's going to benefit the other person. Robert says, with truths in the Vedas, it's like a pharmacy that has all different medicines, but the doctor gives you the medicine that will benefit you, and the medicine that will benefit you now. So as we progress in Krishna consciousness, we are able to hear and be benefited by higher subjects than we are in the beginning. So these are the way that we exchange with devotees, giving and receiving gifts, giving and receiving prasadam, and giving and receiving confidences. And when we associate with devotees like this, we make Krishna happy, we will become inspired in Krishna consciousness, ultimately to become inspired in the higher realms of Krishna consciousness. We will feel very enlivened in a like-minded society of devotees. We'll have examples of Krishna consciousness that we can follow. We'll please Krishna. And just imagine what it would be like to be in a society where we all lived like that. We would actually be nourished. So even if our dealings with the devotees are already on the highest platform, the nice thing about Krishna consciousness is it's not static. You don't reach a place where you say, okay, now I've mastered that. You know, materially it's kind of like that. You reach a point where you go, okay, did that. No more juice in it, huh? But spiritually it's not like that. So each of us, even though I'm sure everyone here is already perfect in their devotee relationships, there's always room for improvement. So we could consider, am I dealing with the devotees in ways that really benefit them and myself? Am I dealing with the devotees in ways that would please Krishna? Is Krishna smiling at how I'm dealing with his devotees? Is he looking and saying, oh, Thank you very much for how you're dealing with the devotees. Let me bring you into my eternal association, where there's an unlimited number of devotees, because you've proved yourself that you are going to deal with the devotees in a sweet way. So I'm sorry we went a little over time, we started a little late. Any questions, comments, additions, subtractions, chastisements? I get them sometimes. Figure might as well ask for them.
That was wonderful. Please give us your blessings that we can improve.
Oh, well, only if you give me your blessings that I can improve. It's wonderful to be back here. So I lived here in 75, 76. I lived here while the altar was being built.
I hope you're moving back.
In that closet.
Back in the closet, huh? I lived in a closet upstairs for 10 months. No windows, no. I don't know, Prabhu.
Where do you live now?
It's hard to say. I have a room in Hawaii at my son's house, but I mostly live in my suitcase. But anyway, it's nice to be here. I'm very happy that I was invited to come here and see Radhagopi Vallabha again. Actually, the most wonderful thing about when I lived here were the other devotees that were here. Yes, Prabhu.
In your class, you mentioned that sometimes we can go like a month without talking to other devotees about Krishna.
Yeah, I've seen that. Sometimes years even.
Yeah, I like find that's like a problem in my own life, that sometimes I think I'm associating with devotees, but I'm maybe just like with devotees, but I'm not having like I guess
just do it. Just take the leap. And it, of course, it helps if you're reading and hearing. If you're not reading and hearing, it's really hard because then you don't have much of anything to say. But if you're reading and hearing, talk about something you read, you know. You can keep some notes somewhere. Note down something you really like. I mean, nowadays with all of our gadgets, that's really easy to do. We have our little portable external brains that we carry around with us. So you can make a little note of something you read and then talk about it with somebody. What you'll find is that the other devotees will like that 99% of the time. And if you meet one who doesn't, then just offer your respects to them from a distance in the future. But most of the devotees will really like that. And it will start sparking a whole wonderful discussion. And you'll walk away thinking, was that nice? So just kind of take the risk of talking about Krishna, directly Krishna, not just talking about this thing that happened and that thing that happened and this thing that has to be done and that thing that has to be done. And this. Try it. See how it works out. The majority of the times I've tried that, it's wonderful, and I'm really happy that I did it, and I think, I got to do that again. That was great. In other words, you don't have to wait for the other person to do it. You have to say, well, they're not talking about Krishna, so I don't know if I should. Because maybe they'll think I'm a sahaji if I talk about Krishna. Anybody else? No? Okay, thank you very much. All glories to Srila Prabhupada.
Thank you all for joining us for the Wednesday feast. And we're especially thankful for Her Grace Mother Urmila Devi Dasi for joining us and giving us a beautiful.